All right, Pierce boy, come on down to John Plus One Town.
Hello.
What's up, everybody? I am with Pierce Cravens, New York City-based filmmaker and producer. Pierce, thanks for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me.
Tonight, we're going to be talking about taking a film or digital series product and selling it to Netflix, what that whole business is about. Pierce has been in the game for how long have you been in this game?
About 10 years.
10 years, so he's like a real decade into this.
Sure.
I just started yesterday, so I'm really, really know what I'm talking about.
You know what, though? It shows.
It does. Yeah. It does show, because I don't know shit! All right, specifically starting off, we're going to be speaking about selling to streaming services specifically. So you have had a lot of background in making films with production companies or making films kind of solely on your own. When did you start getting some of these, I don't know, what do you call them, like products or something?
Well, I mean, just any project becomes a product. I mean, it's like any other business. You produce something and bring it to market for sale.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And even though that kind of sounds like you're taking some of the creativity and some of the art out of it, at the end of the day, it is a business. So not only do I want to find something that is both creatively fulfilling, but also commercially viable for what I'm trying to do. And the cool thing is that with the proliferation of these...
Big word alert.
Yeah.
Don't know what that means yet, but we'll find out and get back to you about it.
Of these streaming services and different platforms that you can put your content on, the amount of revenue that you can derive has increased in various different ways.
So you think that the streaming services are helping filmmakers like yourself?
I think they are. I think at the end of the day, they are kind of like a filter because the price of film making has gone down so much. They become a filter through which the cream can rise to the top, I guess, so to speak. And I think it's a lot of different people, that's where they go to for their content. Just because YouTube is so prevalent and anyone can make a film, and I guess Netflix and Hulu and Amazon, they become go-to platforms where people can kind of...
Are there other things aside from streaming services that you're using now as opposed to, you know, 9 years ago when you were getting started, to put like your films and productions online?
It depends on the type of production. Mm-hmm. I have been partnering with some digital partners, certainly with Netflix and with Amazon, but also with some other services out there like Crackle and Vimeo and, you know, YouTube Red and some other things.
Do they take like an aggressive cut? Are they difficult to deal with? Are they just sort of impossible to get into?
No.
Sort of at a level where it's like, hey, I got this great stuff. You want it? And they're like, yes, please give it. We have all these hungry college kids.
They're definitely hungry for content.
Yeah.
I think all of these services are hungry for content.
Yeah.
Everyone's hungry for content.
Everyone.
Just eating it on up. But, you know, I think we're kind of in a new golden age of content in that sense.
Yeah.
And I think that right now there are companies that are so hungry that they may overeat a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And I think through the next couple of years you're going to see
people drop off.
The tapering off of the amount of projects that they're grabbing.
Yeah. Yeah. I saw that Blip TV used to be big.
They're
gone now.
Yeah.
They were like a very similar streaming service to YouTube, and they sort of just said, you know what, we can't compete with this stuff, we're gone.
That, and also I think that certainly Netflix is going more internal.
Mm.
I think a lot of companies
are
internally producing and internally developing projects as opposed to outsourcing them from maybe a producer like me.
Mm-hmm.
They'll hire someone like me on their payroll develop and create and produce, a series or a film or a documentary.
Do you think that Netflix was the pioneer with that? I mean, with House of Cards, I think maybe it was one of their first like super popular series. I mean, were they the ones to be like, hey, you know, because they had to wait to get to get, you know, good stuff so streaming.
Right.
Know? So they're like, let's just make our own stuff. And then when they realized that format, they were just like banging out, you know,
but
stuff.
But I mean,
left
they
right.
they put a huge chip down mm-hmm. on House of Cards. I mean, it was A-list directors, A-list talent.
Yeah. It looks good too.
Yeah, and it's amazing.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
But then
so,
it seems like it started to taper off with some of their other stuff.
I still think it looks amazing.
Yeah.
But I think that they have been getting into more of a more of an indie vibe with mm-hmm. Most recently Keenan Peele's Friends from College.
Yes, yes.
That just got
yes.
renewed for season two.
Uh-huh.
Like great ensemble cast,
yeah.
But it has more of an indie feel to it. It's
mm-hmm.
not like a gigantic budget House
yeah.
of Cards
yeah.
drama.
Yeah, it's sort of like a more indie feel. It's easier to produce. Does it
yeah.
come across as like, okay, this is significantly more shitty as a thing to watch, or is it just like it's indie and we get that?
No, I mean it just has an indie feel.
Okay.
That's kind
it's
of
organic.
The yeah exactly
yeah. cool
yeah.
I mean, specifically, these streaming services, they're taking a lot of stuff that's live now, too, and they're putting it on their show. I mean, I've seen it with the Met Opera's doing it now,
mm-hmm.
too. They're doing live performances, and they're showcasing it on. Pierce's, one of his most recent works was Oh Hello on Broadway with Nick Kroll and John Mulaney.
Nick Kroll and John Mulaney.
John Mulaney.
Available on Netflix everywhere.
Available on Netflix everywhere. Maybe. Not for long. But it was a fantastic show. Two-person show with a guest
yeah.
would come on. It was like hilarious. Huge hit on Broadway. And now it's on Netflix.
Right.
So we want to talk about taking a like a live show like that. Introduction, you know, changes. And then bringing it to streaming services. So can you tell us about, was it like sort of your initial goal as a producer for this great like live stage show to get it on a streaming service, just to keep it alive, or was it originally meant for that?
You know, we ended up producing that at the tail end of the Broadway
yeah.
show.
Yeah.
So that was kind of the cherry on top of a great experience and of a great run,
mm-hmm.
both critically and commercially.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
For us, you know, I don't know. I think that it was something that certainly intrigued their fan base.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so that's kind of what opened the door to that.
Right.
What was interesting to me is that that I guess Comedy Central didn't come in there and want to do that, because they also produced the show with us.
Okay.
And certainly with Kroll Show.
Yeah.
Being on Comedy Central, we thought that it would be, you know, a no-brainer.
Yeah.
But all of a sudden, Netflix kind of came up, and that's kind of where
it
landed.
This is ours.
Yeah.
So has Comedy Central, have you seen, made any, like, attempts at doing what Netflix is doing now? I mean, with making their own content, streaming it, like, as a subscription-based server? Or are they just sort of like, here's our shows?
No, I think, you know what, and this is just my own opinion.
Yeah.
I don't know for certain, but I think that
Insider's own opinion, so it's better than my opinion, which is hopeless.
I think that the show, because it was not necessarily a stand-up show,
mm-hmm.
it was a legitimate Broadway play.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was kind of out of the stand-up special wheelhouse that Comedy Central is so great at producing.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know if the unknown of that
right.
was a bit too big of a hump to get over.
Yeah, yeah. That's interesting. That's
you know, I don't know. That's just
yeah.
That's you know, cool. That's
so Netflix sort of saw the action. We're like, we can do this.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So is it like show by show, or is it just like is it like one segment? I have not seen it.
It's thank you so much for
on Netflix. I haven't
so
seen
that,
save myself.
It depends. I think that we are the first show that has been on Netflix.
Yeah, no, that's the thing. I haven't seen any. That's
the first
why I like.
The first Broadway show that
yeah.
has been taped and premiered on Netflix.
Yeah.
I know that John Leguizamo had a show actually in the same theater, the Lyceum Theater,
really?
Called Freak, which
yeah.
was his one man show that Fisher Stevens produced
mm-hmm.
or and directed. And they produced that for HBO, I
okay.
think, as well.
Okay.
And then through the years, I think that it's filtered down to Netflix as
yeah.
well. But yeah, there's a movement to filming and producing
yeah.
these types of shows for platforms like Netflix and HBO, and certainly, you know, Phantom Events is doing a lot of the operas, as you mentioned, and there's a company out there called Broadway HD, which is a Netflix-type service.
I
it's
see.
A subscription-based service where I think you pay $9.99 a month.
For a Chinese guy to go in there with a camera and film the whole thing.
Well, actually, it's just a puppet theater version.
Of the Broadway show.
Right, of the Broadway show.
With no puppets, it's just fingers.
Just the finger puppets, so, and one guy.
And he's
one
not
guy.
Chinese, though.
He's, you know, nice guy. No.
He's a great guy,
sweet.
We love him.
Real sweet
him.
Guy, Joe. But yeah, so there is the movement. There's the movement for that, and I do feel like there's an appetite for that. Mm-hmm. Especially with Hairspray and Peter Pan on NBC, those live musicals that you were talking about. I think there's an appetite there.
Because I'm wondering if the live translates well to a streaming. So like me sitting on my bed with the computer on my chest watching it, I'm getting the same kind of feeling of me being there with the live, actually showing that there's a live audience, that it's a stage.
Right.
Are some people feeling like, well, you know, this is just a guy filming from a seat?
I think it's tough. Yeah. I think it's really tough because a lot of the magic of live theater is witnessing it with other people and responding with them as you respond to the actors on stage.
Yeah.
So that's one thing. And also another thing is personally, I don't know how well some theatrical productions translate to the screen.
That's true. Yeah, okay. Yeah.
Because for a variety of different reasons, just because of the space, actors have to play to the balcony.
Right.
And whereas with a film or with a TV show or with any sort of that format, your window is so small.
Yes.
So you have the ability to play things a lot smaller.
Got
so when you're filming something that is being played so broad, it looks broad.
Yeah.
And it feels unnatural and kind of forced sometimes.
Yeah.
But I think in the case of Oh Hello,
It was sort of fixed.
Yeah,
stage.
But being that these characters are already so
broad
and so much of a caricature themselves, I think it worked.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, I think it works too. I mean, it works in both formats. Partly because I mean, the action is pretty. I don't know. It's on stage, but it sort of goes horizontal. You don't kind of feel like we have to go all over the place.
Exactly.
But either way, it works out both ways. Oh Hello is on Netflix. It's streaming super fast.
Check
and
it out.
HD, hopefully.
Yes.
Well, while we were on Netflix, digging around, looking at all the different things, we found all these titles that people like. You've never even heard of these movies before. And that's sort of the beauty of Netflix, too, is they'll take sort of like one-off movies and they'll show them, and you kind of find yourself in this warp of watching Antonio Banderas in the 90s portraying some beautiful person. And then so...
and now not so much.
Right,
he's a beautiful
man. He's
a beautiful man.
And so what we're going to do now is we're going to take about, I don't know, it's a lot of random Netflix titles we found. I'm going to give us 2 minutes to give you a brief synopsis of what that film is about so you can decide whether you want to watch it or not. The way it's going to work is there's going to be a really groovy-ass timer right here, and we are going to go over as many titles as we can. We got title cards, which is sweet. We're going to pick it up. I'm going to read it. I'll say the title.
Okay.
Ding the bell. Then you get to go. Ring the title. Ding the bell. I encourage you to just chuck it after you're done doing it.
I'm not going
to
remember
any of it.
Do I ring the bell?
She better not.
Who's ringing
up?
The bell?
It's going to start
shit.
After you're done. You smack like that. I will start.
Got
it. So we'll go off now. 2 minutes, ladies and gentlemen.
Here we go.
The first film is called Tangerine. And Tangerine is a movie about two farmers in Canada that are struggling to make their vegetables appeal to the meat-eating generation. Here,
wow.
Go for it.
All right. Okay, we have the movie Rounders with Matt Damon and Edward Norton. Obviously, Rounders is a baseball film where Matt Damon and Edward Norton are just on the field with the bat on their heads, rounding the bat over and over again. It's a two-hour drama to see who can stand.
Camp X-Rays with Kristen Stewart. Kirsten Stewart. I don't know how to pronounce the name. But she is the hot lady in the vampire film. She's making her return to Scream in this hit cult comedy where she's the camp counselor at a camp of X-ray students learning how to properly use the X-ray. Unfortunately, one kid gets lost in the X-ray and she has to find it.
Wow.
That's good news.
World of Tomorrow. It's a movie where constantly you are being projected into the next day. So you never get a sense of time. The sun never sets. Or it never rises, depending on where you are in the world. There's a, it centers in a place called Little Diomede, which is, the easternmost, oh no, the westernmost island in the Alaska Aleutian Islands where you can actually look into tomorrow.
Boom, ding the bell! Snowpiercer is a runner-up from the Jamaican bobsled team Cool Runnings, featuring the elusive career of Pierce Cravens.
It's a biopic.
As a bobsledder himself coming from Norway.
Doing one more.
We got one more.
All right, the best offer, Jeffrey Rush. This entire film is Jeffrey Rush giving you the best offer you could ever possibly get. For example, $1 million for this car.
Through selling, I just want to add on to this because this is the best film. He returns to the screen as Captain Barbossa and gives you the best offer on used pirate ship. That's it, ladies and gentlemen. That was your Netflix title read-off. Pierce Cravens, everybody. Make sure you check out Olo on Netflix. That was John Plus One. We'll see you next week, or maybe in 2 weeks. Thank you very much, baby.